Thank you very much, Mr. Batra, for setting the tone for this edition of the Conclave as well. And on that note, ladies and gentlemen, we'll get started with our first plenary session of the day. This is where our experts will be debating on transit-oriented development for Bengaluru. So let me again repeat, the topic being transit-oriented development for Bengaluru. But first up, before I invite our panelists on the stage, we have a video on this topic that we'd like to play. So let's take a look at the AV, please. I've just been informed right now that we do not have the video as yet, so we're just going to directly invite our panelists on the stage. Let's get started, and first up, invite our session moderator. We have with us Mr. Amit Obroy, who's the National Director, Knowledge Systems with Colliers International. So if I may please invite Mr. Obroy on stage. He, in fact, is an experienced real estate professional and has worked on projects in South Asia, Latin America, as well as USA. Well, joining him, our next speaker, Mr. G. Raghavan, who's the CEO of Bhartiya City Developers Private Limited. Let's keep that applause going to welcome all our panel members as well. He's been leading this large mixed-use city development enterprise with focus on value creation through design-centric residential, commercial, and retail assets. Our next esteemed speaker, ladies and gentlemen, architect Subbaiah T S, the secretary of IIA, founder Urban Morph, Urban Design Think Tank as well. In fact, he's also the principal architect of Subbaiah Design Architect, and he's also the co-founder of the startup Bioman Technologies that has a sustainable technology to manage the wet waste of the city. Warm welcome. Moving on to our next speaker, Mr. Srinivasan Subhamanian, who's the CEO of SNN Builders, who comes with more than 30 years of prolific experience in advertising, communications, and marketing as well. Our next speaker, ladies and gentlemen, we have with us the CEO and Managing Director, Hutz Global, General Secretary of CREA and Country PR Head, and Governing Council of NAR India as well. We have with us Mr. Samir Arora. Please put your hands together to welcome Mr. Arora as well. His company, Hutz Global, a company established in the year 2006, offers real estate consultation and property management services as well. Moving on to our next speaker, we have with us the principal architect and managing partner of Venkatraman Associates, Mr. Naresh Narasimhan, to please come on stage. A practitioner of over 30 years of experience in architecture as well as urban design. Well, moving on to our final speaker for the session, we have with us Mr. Balakrishna Hegde, who is the founder and managing director of Chartered Housing Private Limited. He's also the past president of CREDAI Karnataka and currently the mentor of CREDAI Karnataka and executive committee member of CREDAI National. Please put your hands together to welcome all our panel members, and we'll get the session started again with Mr. Amit Obroy taking forward from here. We're just getting the mics ready, sir.
Could we have that light turned off, please, or at least dimmed? Yeah, perfect. Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this session. And it's a pleasure to have such a distinguished panel here, comprising of leading developers of Bangalore, an activist, an architect who has very strong opinions on the infrastructure in Bangalore, and from the real estate sector, Mr. Samir, and sir yourself. And I'm sorry we couldn't play your video, but let's start with you, and let's talk about what people do globally as a best practice, and you were mentioning about the Middle East, and what are the best practices people do in transit-oriented development?
Hi, good afternoon, everybody. Basically, the subject is very interesting in terms of how each of the city should develop in terms of TOD is concerned. And I did a bit of a research and found one of the videos which was really interesting, which I found in Alberta in Canada, where they talk about specifically on the subject how this could be brought out, and if it is brought out really well in terms of the connectivity, the modal, multimodal kind of transport system, and how a complete street should be developed and in this kind of a development. It's very interesting, and maybe as we progress, I think the other participants also will contribute in terms of specific reference to Bangalore. Actually, Bangalore is one of the most fastest developing metros as far as real estate is concerned, because all said and done, the price is still reachable, and people can afford to have even for 2 crores a really a luxury apartment in Bangalore. So a lot of investments are coming, a lot of interest is there, and BMRCL on its part is trying to do, government is on its part trying to do, but somewhere I think so. People have to ensure that all the parties involved should be involved in this, and then trying to develop a broad system which works really well.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. And probably over the course of this session, we'll get an opportunity to see the video that you've put together. It's ready? Yeah. Let's have a look at that. I think we should start on a positive note, looking at what the best practices are.
City Council's recently for the City of Edmonton, a long-term 30-year vision that speaks to things like building a compact city, shifting Edmonton's transportation mode. And from there, we have the Transportation Master Plan and Municipal Development Plan that will have policies that integrate transportation and land use and develop these land use plans around transit nodes and corridors.
Transit-oriented development really fits into our vision of the future of Edmonton, and that it'll have a major role in how the city is shaped over the future. Transit-oriented development is about creating density and proximity to some sort of a transit facility, be it an LRT station or a premium bus stop.
The transit stations and the development around transit stations isn't just going to be about housing. We want to make sure that there's civic facilities. It could be a library, it could be a community facility, it could be neighborhood shops and cafes. It's a mixture of residential, employment, perhaps some commercial land uses, all within good close proximity to public transit, so that it's a place where people want to go, not only to take the bus or to take the train, but also to meet and to do their daily activities.
So that we're offering choices for people to live and work in places that make transit desirable and that provide the efficient form of energy and sustainable transportation that transit is all about. Across North America and in Europe and in Asia, there are a wide variety of cities where most people choose not to use automobiles most of the time. In all these cities, we find many neighborhoods where most of the trips that people take during the day are on foot or by transit. And again, people have cars for shopping with heavy items or for weekend trips. In cities where people live and work more closely to one another, public transportation can operate more efficiently. And of course, that's what we want. We want an efficient city as well as an accessible city.
By implementing a nodes and corridor concept, what we're seeking to achieve is to locate extra density. In so doing, we're going to be creating certain efficiencies. We're going to be creating ridership for the system itself, which hopefully will certainly justify its cost. We're going to get less need for vehicle use. We're going to get people walking more. We're going to get a more green city out of that. So there are going to be a number of benefits that we're going to see out of the TOD development.
Absolutely, it makes sense economically, and we're looking again for long-term economic viability for the city, recognizing that the way that we've been developing today is just not going to be viable for the long term. We want to make sure what we're doing is in line with what the public is wanting to have for this city. They spoke, we listened, this is really what they want to see for the city for the long term, and that's why we're moving in that direction.
And as markets get stronger and as the Alberta economy gets stronger in the years ahead, new development will start to occur. So we not only need to have policies to support our transit system, but we also need real estate investment to occur in and around those stations. The combination of the public's policies and the private's investments will create the transit-oriented development that we desire.
So for the citizens of Edmonton, the payoff is, over the longer term, that we will transform our city, and by that we will become more livable, we'll become more sustainable, we'll consume less agricultural land in and around the city.
And that's what good, accessible public transit can do in the long term.
Thank you, sir. That was quite informative, and I'm sure we've all learned a little bit. Could we dim the lights again, please? So that was quite informative. Thank you so much. And it's good to have a best practice. And then it was very interesting to read what Bangalore has done, which is one paragraph included in the master plan, which in my opinion, and I'm an outsider, I'm from Gurgaon, I'm not a citizen here. But to me, it seemed like a one paragraph, tick the checkbox and make sure that it really does not impact the city. Mr. Narasimhan, would that be a correct assessment? What are your opinions on that?
There are multiple views on TOD. Okay, it's not the panacea that it's rolled out to be. Let's understand that anything that is proposed is not immediately something which everybody has to immediately adopt. There is a bunch of advocates promoting transit-oriented development, or the toddness, as you put it. It's called the toddness movement. And there is another bunch of people who are saying that, is it a smart idea to cram more and more people into smaller and smaller areas? Or is it better to create, I mean, for India, India hasn't built any new cities except one since independence, which is in 1956, which is Chandigarh. Is it a smarter idea instead to build 100 new cities of, say, 3 to 4 million people each, rather than trying to densify existing cities? It all sounds very utopian and very great to say that, you know, let's do mixed use. The trouble is we already are mixed use. And the other thing is that to increase the density. Unfortunately, I think the density is already too high. Right? And you know, and you can already see in the case of the Bangalore Metro, when phase one was opening, it was a Mickey Mouse train. Right? Because it only went in one, were a little bit. Within like 2 weeks after it's opened, more than 4 lakh people are riding the train every day. And you cannot even get in. I mean, now you have to wait 3 times in any central city station just to get into the train. You know, 3 trains have to pass. Otherwise, you can't get in. So I'm not so 100% convinced that transit-oriented development is being touted like some panacea for Indians' urban issue. But I think we should keep an open mind and look at larger issues. That being said, some of the principles of transit-oriented development should be implemented, whether you put transit or not. The major focus of a city's investment should not go on flyovers, should not go on heavy infrastructure, but rather go on what I call the number 11 mode of transport, which is your own two legs. Increased investment in pedestrianization. You know, when you go abroad, you notice that the richest guy takes the tube, right? And so a developed country is a country in which rich ride public transportation. And many people walk to work. I mean, I noticed that I have a step counter in my phone with some pedometer kind of app. In Bangalore, I land up doing 6,000 steps. I went to Italy 2 weeks back, I did 18,000 steps. And I didn't notice any difference at all. I mean, and instead of going to a gym and working it out, I think it's smarter to walk around and do exercise. The idea that we keep referring to stuff in India like saying this is the CBD and that is the suburbia and all that. These are all completely outmoded concepts based on fossil fuel, endless fossil fuel availability that every day you drive to a job and every day you drive back home. India naturally has a mixed use philosophy, and we should actually encourage that and give it graded zones of quiet as the distance from the main road increases. I'm not saying allow shops at every street corner, but in a clever way that you do not have to take out your car or a motorized vehicle if you want to buy some toothpaste. You should be able to walk. There should be convenience stores. Lastly, I would like to make the point that one of the key aspects of the TOD policy is to increase the FSI along the transit line. Right? To Bangalore, it's now close to 4, within 150 meters of every station. But what about the impact on the infrastructure which is there? Already the water line is not enough, the sewage line is not enough, and the power is not enough. You go and increase an FSI which is 1.5 or 2 to double that, right? Who is, and mind you, there is no impact fee being charged by the corporation. Really speaking, that extra FSI, you should be able to buy it as premium FAR, and that premium FAR should be used to increase the infrastructure capability of that line along which TOD is done. So there are a lot of gaps. Curiously, this has been going on in India since 1992 is when I first heard TOD name come up in India. This is now 25 years. And still it has not made any great impact in any planning policies of, except maybe a little bit in Ahmedabad and a little bit in Bhopal and a little bit in Naya Raipur. And Bangalore, you can say it's almost non-existent. The station came up and now everybody is calling the area around the station TOD. It didn't come up the other way around. So I'd like to you to temper your optimism to the others also and look at it on both sides.
So you have a very interesting view on increasing FSI and making things more compact and therefore the impact on infrastructure. In your opinion, if I may summarize, in your opinion, therefore it is better to have a more walkable city, a more friendly city, walk to work, a sort of concept which probably gels in more with a city like Bangalore where we are already struggling with the traffic congestions. So given that light, do you think, and what was very interesting about this policy is that it only applies to Zone B. So do you think that is a...
We see that government is already pumping a lot of money in mobility infrastructure, public mobility infrastructure within the city. But now the encouragement of higher FSI is outside. So if you're talking about a walkable city, a little contrary to what Naresh was saying, there's already so much of money being pumped in and already you're creating infrastructure for people to adopt public transport. So if you can create developments where you have work and stay in the same place, that kind of infrastructure being developed in the places already where money is being pumped in, it will promote walking and pedestrianization better. For example, if you see, especially in Bangalore, Yashwantpur as a junction, if I want to take, having a railway station, bus stand, and all those things happening in the vicinity, we've seen huge amount of infrastructure come in. I mean, a lot of housing. And those housing sell fast, right? Why? Because there's also place to work close by. There's people can travel to different places. And these places have now, the real estate prices have gone up. But only thing that's lacking finally is to interconnect them all with some proper pedestrianization and all things. Like he said, the things put in first and then people randomly come and build around that whole place because now they have find that people are flocking into that place. So if in the planning stage itself, you factor for these things and, you provide for large pieces of land. And second thing is, pooling land together for especially for large builders and other things. So if you're having small houses or small plots in all these prominent locations, you will not definitely have development that we're looking at. Even if you give FAR of 4 or 3 or 4, you can never have that kind of development because the plot size are so high. So when planning goes in, you need to plan such a way that these... And one advantage we see of having large developments in a small place is because then you can really track what are the violations. Small violations done by small plots never get traced and you can never catch them. But at least builder does a violation in a thing. It's prominently seen and you can at least get them in. You will find large open spaces plus all this happening so that promotes people to go in for mass transport. You'll stop using cars because you can walk down or you can connect to a workplace. So there's a lot of thought that we are trying to put in again, especially Bangalore. A lot of architects like Naresh and all of them have been very active in trying to see how we can influence the master plan right now and see if we can make some changes. Right now it's up for revision.
So would one of the challenges, Mr. Hegde, be the fact that it's only in Zone B? Is the challenge that land is very fragmented in the city and therefore to even be able to consume that 4 FSI given the road width and the setbacks that you have, you may not be able to consume the FSI. Would that be the reasoning why it's in Zone B? And do developers, are you enthused by the fact that there is a TOD and therefore a real estate opportunity with that?
Before that, probably TOD, of course, like Narasimhan said, and everyone has an opinion on that. But in the naturally, the TOD concept is already built into our urban space. Like you look at it, Bombay, there are 3 lines, central, urban, harbor line. All development, most of it is on those 3 lines. And around the station, you can, like Narasimhan said, you can probably get everything from a hat to a dress to a garment. I mean, you don't have to go to a supermarket to buy all those things. So TOD-ness is already there ingrained in our system. We don't have to invent it. Because somebody has given a name to it. That's it. But the problem is the haphazardness that has come into. Because there is no planning. You're talking about FAR and the Zone B, etc. Ideally, we are the kings. Developers are the kings of the cities. We decide where to put what. How many apartments, how many towers, and what is the size, and everything is decided by us. And honestly speaking, without much of research. Then we go and tell Narasimhan, okay, I want 18 towers of 30 floors, and this is the size, and everything. Narasimhan builds it, plans it, and I build it. Ideally, it should be the other way around. The city should... Cities should decide as to what to come and where, zone B, zone A, what should be the density, what should be the plot size, what are the things to be commercial, retail, entertainment, residential. Everything has to be predetermined by the city so that there is no sprawl nor a haphazard, irrespective whether it is a TOD or the kind of development that we see in Bangalore, the circular development. It has to be pre-designed for the entire area. This is where we go wrong. Narasimhan rightly said about the infrastructure. Yeah, it's not just the FAR. Whether do you have the infrastructure to take that FAR? Money should have been already pumped in. I slightly disagree with you. It is not that the money collected from me for the premium FAR should be used. It should be pre-invested in that. Okay, yes, it should have been pre-invested in that area. Then you should ask me to build.
Yeah, I meant that it should be recovered as premium.
Yeah, correct. both are in the same page. So it is the problem is not the concept. Problem is the way in which we implement or we don't implement at all. As you said, you see half a page or one paragraph of TOD. Let it be any concept. Let it be half a page, but have the seriousness and commitment to implement it. We had a 2015 RMP. There is nothing which has happened after 2007, after release of RMP. We have been building according to our whims and fancies. Government has been doing flyovers or no flyovers, or somebody objects to the Beku Beda, then they cancel it. Honestly speaking, I don't know whether flyover is good or not. Any infrastructure should be there because any government people. It is not just in flyover that people eat money. They eat money in every project. Flyover is gone, some small things have come, there also money will be there.
Thank you for the very candid views, and I hope there are no government people here. But, you know, what is a little, on a very serious note, what is a little saddening is the fact that TOD, whether we agree with it, whether transit as such, Bangalore needs it really badly, right? To have a proper transit system, which can take care of all the congestion. We work in this space where we all ask our MNC clients to come in. A lot of them say, do I really want to be here where I do 3 meetings a day and I'm spending 5.5 hours in the car commuting? So I think that's a very valid point.
See, the point that a city will endlessly grow is a stupid one. We cannot endlessly grow this city. I mean, forget about whether IT companies want to come and open here or not. There is simply not enough water. That's all. So forget about whether we have connect broadband or connectivity or you're able to zip around in half an hour from place to place. The city simply does not have water. And if you do not understand, and I have been telling the government, Karnataka has 9 other cities, right? What stops you taking this money instead of pumping it into flyovers and other useless projects inside the city and building a highway from Bangalore up to Bidar, 6-lane highway, let it go straight up and develop every other city in Karnataka. It's not, Karnataka is a one state. We're all nice people everywhere, not only in Bangalore. And I think, you know, Bangalore, Udupi, Kundapur, Bagalkot, Bidar, stop developing Bangalore. I think we, and between the architects and the developers and the community, we will take care of it. I think the government should move its capital to Davangere and sit, or Belgaum or something like that, and leave us alone. Then Bangalore will recover. Nothing will happen. Companies do not come here because there is bad traffic. They don't come here because there's not enough water. They don't come here because there is now too many mosquitoes. They come here because Bangalore is the largest critical mass of scientific and computer talent in the entire planet. And nothing you can do about traffic will change that. They will come here anyway. The point I am trying to say is the government should get out, not the companies. The companies then will keep coming without any problem.
That's really interesting, sir. And I will tell you, I've worked in the planning for a very long while. Getting a new city to develop is a challenge because you don't get the critical mass. For very long, Ahmedabad has been saying that they will be the next financial center as Bombay. We've been hearing that for the last 15-20 years. Boston has been saying that they will replace New York, but there's a critical mass. Unfortunately, we can't change Bangalore.
I'm monopolizing the mic, but there are 8 locations around Bangalore. You know, Nelamangala, Magadi, Yashwant, whatever you call it, or Devanahalli, Hoskote, Hosu, the Attibele side. Why can't the government take all this money? I want to see somebody proudly say that, you know, some IBM should say, oh, our office is in Nelamangala downtown, CBD. They never say that, right? They all want to be in Whitefield or someplace, and or maybe on behind us.
So I'll take a cue.
So why can't these, if we do that, and each of our Tumkur, for instance, a smart city, if you start pushing Bangalore quality infrastructure into those places, many people who are crying right now will quietly go there and the problem will go away.
And same talent will be there.
Yeah, let them go and do that challenge there. At least it's a lesser problem than Bangalore with high real estate values, right? We put a ring railway all around and connect it back into the center if you really need to come inside. A lot of Whitefield guys today say, oh, you live in Bangalore, is it? We'll come there once in a while. So I think they should also secede and become the new Republic of Whitefield or something like that.
So we'll take a cue on the IBM and the fact that we'll go to North Bangalore, sir. What has been your experience and what have you done in your Bhartiya city?
Okay, thank you. I feel pretty odd to be sitting in this panel because we are building, I represent Bhartiya city, which will be a 25 million square feet, well-contained, mixed-use city in North Bangalore. And what we're really doing is a completely transport non-oriented, a transport non-dependent city that we're building. So with a little small touch of arrogance, I should say that when all of the panel members were talking about an utopian situation of walking to work and cycling to work, that's exactly what we are doing, although in a very, very micro scale compared to the overall requirements. So what we have done is a few things. One is, first of all, the whole city, people will be able to walk from one place to another. We made sure that the walking pathways are well laid out and well maintained, and they'll be so maintained throughout the life of the city because we've got that taken out of the individual asset classes so that that never gets compromised. And every one of the walking tracks, walking paths does have another cycling track, which also covers the entire length and breadth of the city, so you can actually cycle to work, and it is not a concept, it is a reality. And in addition to that, what we have also done is to provide a few places where cycles are parked, so you can actually take cycle from one part of the city and ride to another part of the city and leave it there and go to work. Although that system is still in the teething trouble stage, it's not been fully developed, but it's there and people do cycle. Many of our customers, when they come, they cycle. Sometimes I take a cycle and go around the city. And apart from all that, you know, the usual stuff of planning the traffic, so that there are no congestion points, there is no breakage point and things like that. We have developed the city in a way that people are able to move around very, very smoothly, and that will be the case for all the time. Not only across different asset classes within the Bhartiya city, as well as within the city in terms of the traffic within the individual assets that we have done something like that. So really speaking, eventually there will be about 150,000 people who will either live there or work there or visit the city one way or the other, with about 6,000 homes, from about 5 or 6 million square feet of IT space, retail space, hospitality, school, hospital, everything will be there. Now, when I think of transport-oriented development, of which I know very little, I should confess, what I can think of is basically seamlessness. Although I do agree that we should really work hard to decluster the cities, but I look at it as two phases. One is all the conversations that we're having here to reach the government and then them really getting on to doing something. It's a decade-long program, even if they say yes to it today. So there is a here and now situation, and there is a metro, there is metro and further development and so on and so forth. I think if we can put the energy in making it seamless, which is to say, there are lots of catchment areas from which people have to reach the metro stations. And if one can think about privatizing and enabling satellite transport systems, then there can be a seamless usage. So also the development of, people don't stop life just because they're going to go into a metro and go by train. I mean, if you look at any other city, you can buy a newspaper, like you were saying, you can buy a lot of things on the way, you can pick up a cup of coffee, and it's not an ordeal to continue to live while you're actually transporting yourself from work to home or home to work. So there is a certain amount of design thinking that needs to go into the lives of people to make it as seamless and smooth as possible. So I think while it's going to be a long time before Bangalore city is going to be decongested, it is true that people in Whitefield and people in Richmond Town are not going to be friends for a long time. They're going to visit once in vacation days and things like this. It's true. But having said this, there is a here and now situation. I feel that if you look at seamlessness of transportation, so that actual existing infrastructure is better leveraged, better used, it'll be quite a boon. That's what I think.
Thank you, and I must say it's very well designed, your Bhartiya city. Taking on, Samit, from seamlessness, would you like to talk about your experience in Munich?
Amit, the first thing I would like to say is I've really felt at home here with the stalwarts. Because it's only at home that I keep quiet for so long till the end, you know, in front of my wife. Okay, jokes apart, and with due regard, sir, I would like to differ a little bit. Some of these cities like New York, parts of Canada, Middle East, are very highly advertised on the term Todd. But if you look at some of the real developed countries in Europe, obviously the densities are lower, but if you look at Munich, from any place to any place, in the suburb to the middle parts of the city, the last mile connectivity is absolutely not more than 20 steps of walking. There are common card systems, whether you take the tertiary satellite system, the bus, the smaller train, or the metro, or a public van. And that, I think, essentially invigorates and vitalizes the whole city, builds a whole vibrant environment. I personally think the CBD has to remain the CBD. The growth has to be higher in here. It should not be 150 meters. It should be a minimum of 500 meters to 800 meters. Because, and as you said, it has to be a walkable city. Because walking, bicycling, which is the key factor to the growth of any of it, and the pedestrian movement, as long as these three are built, you're not only building a decongested city, you're building a healthy society. And I think that's extremely important. Right now, they've done the Silk Boat to the KR Puram work on the metro is starting. It will take a few years, and that's one of the biggest corridors that's being built up. But if you look at the dense junctions around, say something like a Sarjapur Road, which probably is one of the highest density in 3 kilometers anywhere in the country, not just in Bangalore, but anywhere in the country. Now, until unless you pre-plan the last mile connectivity, the traffic and the issues will continue for a rapid system also. And which is where, as you rightly said, it gets overloaded. And that has to be planned today. So I think those would be the key factors that we'll need to get in.
Sir, you have a project in Bangalore where before this meeting we had a small huddle and you were talking about the experiences. What can be done under whether TOD or simple transportation or otherwise to make it much more better?
We don't have larger projects like Bhartiya City where it's self-sustained with everything, but we do have some of the projects which are closer to those areas. But basically what, as Naresh said, basically, but first we should put the people on bus and then decide where to drive it. You know, we do the other way around. Now, first we drive and then take the bus along and then pick up people on the way. Okay, let's now form a committee and then do everything. First, they should involve all the parties involved, as I said. If you want to develop the toddness to come into play, it's, as Naresh said, it's pretty difficult in terms of CBD is concerned because most of the land is taken away anyway, because India's population itself is 20% more than, consists of 20% of the world's population, and we have only 5% land available. So it's pretty difficult. Maybe try to develop the periphery where, you know, maybe the connectivity could happen, and then come with some kind of transit system over there where you can develop that, and then come up with a solution around, in and around the periphery. As Naresh said, that it's not necessary everything has to happen only in Yashwantpur or Malleshwaram or elsewhere it is. I think we need to plan that. For doing that, I think all the parties involved should be involved, and then we should take it forward.
Right, sir, thank you so much. As Sapna had promised at the start of this conference, we'll throw it open to the audience for hard question to the panelists.
Can I make one more point?
Sure, please, absolutely.
Okay, actually, many of you have heard of a, when I hear this TOD debate, and I've been part of two or three already, many of you have heard of this Eagles song called Hotel California, right? And there is a line in that which says, you can check out any time, but you can never leave. So many of these TOD developments tend to create, I mean, to paraphrase that line, it says, you can check out any time, but you never have to leave. So TOD is, if you put it in a more colorful way, it sounds like that. Curiously, I was invited to a TOD conference because by surprise I found out that I had created the biggest TOD development in India without my own knowledge, right? Which was an unusual project which all of you know called Brigade Gateway, which is in the northwest part of Bangalore. And but it was not as unknown to me as all that because we had prior knowledge that the metro was going to come there. And in 2004 when we planned it, we came up with this idea called, you know, most developers add an office building next to an apartment and call it mixed use. That is not mixed use. So what I, when we worked with the developer, that is Brigade Group, we told them, let's come up with a new concept in India called mixed up mixed use. Right? Let's mix up the mixed use. So what you are talking about, Bhartiya city, really the precursor, it is the largest single development inside the city of Bangalore, Brigade Gateway. And in 2004, right, it was conceptualized in 2003 or 2004, and it was conceptualized as housing, it was conceptualized as shopping, it was conceptualized as office building, it had a five-star hotel, it has a school, it has a hospital, it has even a club, and it has really lots of hope, and it has a beautiful lake, which is actually only sewage water recycled, which nobody knows. But it, but really speaking, and it's actually almost, it foresaw by intuition, I wouldn't say completely by design, it's almost very low discharge. It almost has no impact on the, I mean, of course it consumes electricity, but it has no great impact. And we find that actually creating a, there is no policy in the government which allows mixed use clearly, except by taking a commercial conversion and then diverting part of that land, part of the this thing. The funniest part of the Brigade Gateway is that it has 6,000 car parking slots. And you would think that with this policy where the government says for every 500 square feet or 50 square meter, you need to provide a parking, 30% of the car park is unoccupied because nobody needs to go anywhere. I think the guys have sold off their cars also, right? So I am looking forward to a situation if a TOD like policy is invented that Bangalore comes up with a maximum car parking norm and not a minimum car parking norm, because if London is a classic example of where TOD-ness is embedded in the city, and the tallest building in Europe, the Shard, which is 14 million square feet, do you know how many parking it has? It has 3 parking slots. That's it, because the railway station is below it. And it has 3 parking slots, one for emergency vehicle, one for the garbage vehicle, and one random vehicle, I think, for the CEO or something. That's it. And can you believe that, you know, I'm looking forward to a city in Bangalore where the commercial buildings have no parking because nobody should bring their car, should discourage people to bring cars to such a place. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Really look forward to a time when we can have no parking. Me and my wife are both working, and we always find that I work in one part of the town and she works in the other part of town, so I wonder how TOD works for us. We've changed 3 times our house, and on all 3 occasions, it's either I work in the North Pole, she works in the South Pole. So those are challenges which we always have, we'll keep proposing. We'll open it up to the audience. I think we should have some hard questions there. Anyone, please. Okay. Yeah, we've got one question. Yeah, please, sir.
the benefit of all, I'll stand and ask. My name is Muralidharan Nair, and I represent a company called Real Docs, which is into legal documentation space in the realty sector. It was wonderful listening to you all with, you know, abundance experience talk about something which looked to me like utopia. The reason being, we have reached a level in Bangalore where I think there has been a lot of haphazard developments. And then, like the gentleman saying, husband works in one area, wife works in another area. Even if we were to invent these TODs, how could this really translate into a reality? Because we are already into it. Bharatiya city may be constructing a wonderful city out there, well-planned, but then we exist outside of it. Hoping that somebody gets an employment inside the city, the other person lives outside. So I don't know how one can, literally integrate this. What would be interesting to know, how has any other city of this nature ever implemented any such plan? Where development has happened haphazarded, there's been problems. Is there a model which can be emulated here, which has already been done elsewhere? If the panel has some answers, it would be interesting.
If you look at Navi Mumbai, which was originally thought of, actually it is the first TOD development of India. And how it has developed, I think it's reasonably successful, right? To some extent, Powai in Bombay is reasonably successful. The Ahmedabad experiment is starting to show results. You can see that the Ahmedabad is a similar problem to Bangalore. It's a radial city and it has a bus rapid transit rather than a metro. But what is happening is that the corridors are being designated as premium FAR. The parking has been reduced on all those corridors, and it is start, and you can already see along the river front and all that, you can see that the changes are happening. But it's still early days. On one side, I was just telling him that, somebody told me yesterday that TOD is promoted by train, metro rail and bus companies to sell more trains and buses, which also may be true. You never know.
My view is that if you look at the number of people living in congested cities as it is now, while we talk about transport-oriented development as a future thing, I think the bigger problem is exactly the kind of thing that you are talking about in terms of where we are already now. I think the transport-oriented development as a concept, if it is limited to the future and is not picking at the current set of problems at very, very micro levels, we are going to keep the people who are living in the existing cities, millions of them, in misery for a very long time. I think the TOD has to have a bifocal viewpoint about making lives easier for people who are already stuck in the situation, making the situation more efficient, do whatever that has got to be done. If it's a road crossing, I think it's absolutely useless if you don't have an escalator on it. People in India are not used to climbing up that was such a very high, pedestrian crossing. They won't do it. So unless we think about it micro level and make life easier and more efficient for the existing people, TOD, the fruits of it are going to be seen by the next generation. We have to really worry about today, and then while we are at it, plan for tomorrow.
As a short-term solution, like we can see, we were a part of Toyota Mobility's challenge recently to see how the metro stations currently that are planned within the city to be made more pedestrian friendly. So what we realized is most of the developers or people who are doing developments and commercial and all those things, you only think of what is happening within your property. You know there's a metro station coming by. How can you think of partnering with the government and say, okay, you have some money of yours, your CSR, or you can partner and say, you can sponsor some escalators like this, the footpaths. Can you partner with having cycle stands? Can you partner with ride sharing apps and say, okay, we'll give you space to park your bicycles in our place. We'll give you space to park your cars in this place, or car pooling or the bike pooling kind of services. So if you partner with metro, partner with government and say, we'll be a part of it, there's value addition to your own property as well. The pedestrians, pedestrianization, cycling, walking, all this will improve. If you see, for example, even in Yashwantpur, there are huge developments which are almost about 21 floors surrounding the metro station, but none of them have thought of investing on the footpaths surrounding the metro station. You cannot, once you get off the metro, you can't get to your property. You have to again probably take a car or you take an Uber to land to your property, which is just about 500 meters from your place. So as builders, I feel as an immediate step, there are already centers. You already have your property. Can you work with local residents? I mean, we are trying as an experiment in Marathali station now. See, if you can work around at least, say, 200 meters or 500 meters around your own properties and see how you can partner with the government. If you expect government to do everything, it will never happen, and we'll just keep having talks and nothing will progress. So if you can extend that way, that will be the first step to see how we can improve the station access to pedestrians and cycling.
Coming specifically to your question, whether it is TOD or creating cities around Bangalore, any concept is fine. Bangalore has already grown haphazardly. So I don't think there is any one concept would work here. Maybe each pocket will have to work out a different concept. Like you see, micro level, Bhartiya is there, Gateway is there. But it has to be replicated in the entire Bangalore. Not in pockets, but everything should be linked together. And we have to, probably we can find a new concept. We have brains here. A committee with Narasimhan and many others can be used to create a concept for Bangalore, which is already grown that heavily. But the problem is nobody is thinking about it. If there is a will, there certainly is a way. Even today, Bangalore can be brought back to its old glory. Even small things, like you see, if you go to Delhi, I'm not talking about the macro level. I'm talking about certain small things which are being undone. We had roundabouts or circles, what we call in Bangalore, which used to give very smooth traffic movement. Even till recently, there were some no roundabouts, but still some crossroads without any signal. It was having a smooth traffic flow. But I see that there is a sudden multiplication of signals everywhere, whether it's traffic is there or not. There is signals and your hold up traffic. Number one, you are wasting time. Number two, you are wasting fuel. Number three, you are adding to the road rage. There are small things which can be done. Reintroduce some roundabouts, not in every place, many places. In Delhi, there are roundabouts till today. No signals. Traffic movement is very smooth. Two, signal cycles, 3 minutes. It's many, many places. On Sundays, you just simply wait and everybody, every other road is empty and everybody is tempted to violate, jump the signal. So these are certain things which can be done at the micro level and at macro level. There should be some thought with a nice group of people like Narasimhan and others who will bring out a new concept or a multiple a concept which is mixture of all the existing concepts.
Yes, sir, please. Could we hand over the mic to the gentleman there? Okay, so my apologies, sir. Okay, last question, sir.
Sure. See, basically, you know, the builders like you guys need to work with the government. I don't understand one thing in Bangalore. Majority of the IT crowd is in Whitefield or Sarjapur or Outer Ring Road. But still, metro is planned on the Kanakpura Road or, you know, initially, which is in the old Bangalore. So I would say, like, until and unless our political system won't improve, in that case, it's difficult. You know, TOD can implement, but still, you know, you guys need to work with the government. So this is Aman from Agarwal Realty. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, sir. And if any, sorry.
See, as I think many of us have also spoken, government never, see, as intellectuals, you have one set of ideas of how the city should work. And the government does the exact opposite because they have other intentions of doing it. It's not that they didn't know that Whitefield needs metro first. But they had other ideas. So I think as a group, we should see with what is provided, how can we work best in that system. I'm sure now where metro is coming up, there are a lot of developers who bought land and doing a lot of sims. Can those developers work together and see how can we better utilize those stations, right? Can you create at least the last mile connectivity between your developments and those metro stations coming up is what developers should think. All of us want to do good to the city, fine. But can you come together, forget your competition between your builders and say, all our properties, can we come together and do the best thing? Can you put loop systems of, you know, last mile connectivity with electric rickshaws or buses or autos, whatever that can give you a last mile connectivity and all your properties will increase. But we don't think of that. We only think, okay, government has not done this. What can we do about it? I think it should be, we have to be proactive in most of the things. They will do exactly what should not be done, right? Like Bangalore, you see the TOD is put as a concept. If Government of India's policy says TOD should be there, but if you see today's BDA's master plan that's announced, it's exactly opposite. TOD is promoted such a big way. Non-motorized transport is provided a big way, and government wants to build flyovers. So that will always happen. So we should see how we can work with the government and see when they are working, we should be even more tactical and say how we can make best use of what they've already given to our system.
Aman, great question, and I'll sum it up very quickly. I know we are running short of time. So as Amit said, he and his wife in Gurgaon work at the opposite ends. I and my wife work together on Sarjapur Road. Good advantage is every time she tells me to go to hell, I start driving there. You know, it's already hell there. But I would sum it up with one line, and I think that's becoming extremely crucial from the question that emanates from here. You know, everybody in terms of a customer and a client will ask for a beautiful place. I think it's the responsibility of the real estate fraternity, whether it's builders, whether it's developers, or whether it's anyone else connected with real estate, to make that place beautiful and work with the government. And Todd, in various parts, needs to be taken up to set up the transit systems to make the place nice. It will ultimately lead to better saleability, and that's very visible from the statistics of wherever it has been implemented.
So just take the
people-oriented development.
Absolutely.
We don't want transit-oriented development.
Absolutely. I was just about to say that to sum up, I think we've had a fantastic session. The cities are extremely complex. We are layers of intricacies that are built into it. There's not just one policy, but we have to make our cities more livable, whether it's TOD or any other policy that we put in, and work together as a group. As a community, and work with the government to make sure our cities are much better. So thank you, everyone. It was a pleasure being on this panel. Thank you so much.
I'm going to request all of you to please remain on the stage. And if I may please invite Mr. Santosh Kumar from Supreme Industries to please come on stage to present a token of gratitude to all of our speakers for the fantastic insights that they've shared and also their valuable presence with us this afternoon. And meanwhile, let's keep that applause going to thank all of our speakers, ladies and gentlemen, for all those individual inputs as well, and for giving a beautiful head start to the conclave. Well, thank you very much. If you can all come together for a group photograph as well, all the panel members, may please come together for a group photograph, please.